Good evening all, welcome to yet another chat session. Today presented by the Madras Canyon Club and hosted by me, Siddhartha. Today we have with us Mr. Dinkar Pratap Singh, an animal and a bird lover, comes from a family of animal lovers, both from the mother and the father side, a hands-on pet person, had Rottweilers from a really young age, and he occasionally shown them as well. He has completed his schooling from the Doon School in Dehradun and college from the Delhi University, after which he moved to Australia for close to 5 years to further studies and work there. He is currently involved in the hospitality business and also farming. He lives between Uttarakhand and Uttar Pradesh, but prefers to live in Uttarakhand for the clean air and the weather. Good evening, Mr. Dinkar, and welcome to this chat session. You have been one of our, I would say, like our ardent person that has been like involved in our chat shows right from day one. I think you asked the most complex and the most thought-provoking questions to all our, and now we have put you on the spotlight so that people can ask you the same type of questions. Thank you so much for agreeing to chat with us about Golden Retrievers. I mean, this is a breed that I think which is close to your heart as well. So, let's get into the first question. A lot of people like to know, can you tell us a little about how you got associated with purebred dogs and especially with labs?
Well, we've always had dogs in our families, and I'm like a dog lover. So we've always had dogs. So throughout my childhood, we've had dogs with us. I've been hearing stories from I was fortunate enough to have my great grandmother who's alive. She used to tell me stories about my grandfather and how well he used to train his dogs. And so my grandmother also used to tell us the various dogs they had, the Cocker Spaniels, German Shepherds, or Labradors. And I was very intrigued by the whole thing about Labradors. And my grandfather actually still has, he's not alive, but his Jeep is there, which is a Ford Jeep from the World War II. And he specially cut the back out and made an extension for his Labradors to sit. Because the Ford Jeeps in the World War II are very small, they're just for people to sit and move. So he'd done that. And so all these things just intrigued me about the Labrador. Unfortunately, I was not really drawn to the breed as such in the beginning. And I was presented a Rottweiler when I was about 10 years old. And ever since then, I had like a couple of Rottweilers always staying with me in my bedroom. So, and I really loved Rottweilers. But it is when my son came in, my elder son, and he grew up, my last Rottweiler, she was about 8 years old. She was not that active with him to play and get the ball and fetch. So I was looking for a larger dog. So that's when we thought Labrador was perfect. It was a very trainable dog, friendly dog, great temperament, easy to train, and the low maintenance. I would say it's a low maintenance dog as well. So that's when I got involved with Labrador. I got one for my son, and he was a very good specimen, so I started showing him. And that's how I got involved. I occasionally breed at times, and that is how I got into Labradors.
Oh, nice. So how many dogs right now at the present you have in your kennel?
Well, I don't have dogs in my kennel. They live in my home. I've got six Labradors and 2 Cavalier King Charles Spaniels.
Oh, that's nice. That's actually a nice breed. I knew somebody who had Cavaliers long time back in Chennai. And I think after that, I haven't seen the breed after a very long time. Let's get into the breed aspect of it as such. What are the unique personalities of the Labrador breed, and why is it such a favorite pet home or a single dog owner, despite there being many breeds available? If you see that, I think this is the most abundant breed that you find in India, I suppose. Like there's every other pet owner who wants to get into a dog always starts with a lab. That's the first question that they want. I want a lab. Or then after that, they go into Goldens and other breeds. But lab is what it comes out. So why is it so prevalent here?
See, labs are very popular all over the world. Take America, take England. They're very popular. And so is it in India as well. Like I said, it's a medium-sized dog. So it's not a very large dog. It's not a small dog. It's in between. So it suits the lifestyle of a lot of people. And like I said, it's very easy to take care of. This dog is easy to take care of. Easy to train. Like I said, it's very biddable. It wants to please the owner all the time. It's wagging its tail. It's always there for you. So it's easy to train. It doesn't bite. They're good watchdog. They can be good watchdogs, but they're not good guard dogs. They would not bite you. With children, they have a lot of pain threshold which they can take. So, and they won't turn on the thing. So even if a child is pulling its ear or thing, it's not advisable, but it would not snap. A lot of breeds would snap back, but this dog would not snap back. Cleanliness wise, again, it's called a double coat. It needs to be brushed at least a couple of times a week. But at the same time, it's very easy to clean this dog. See, you just need to wipe him with a little wet cloth or so, or with a leather glove. He's clean. He really doesn't need to be bathed too many times. If you have a long coated dog, you need to bathe it, brush it, the issues come in. But this dog, you take him out in the rain, puddles, anywhere he comes back, just brush him, comb him, all the dirt falls off, and he's clean. So that way, it's a low maintenance dog, I feel, and its temperament is the main thing. It's a beautiful temperament, very happy dog. It's always there to please you. He's always playing around with you or the children. So that makes it, I think, a very good ideal pet to have as a first pet, especially. It's not a very demanding dog, but yes, it does need a lot of exercise, especially young dogs. They do need a lot of exercise. When I say a lot, I mean morning, evening, take them for a little walk, play in the park with them, then they're fine in the house. But if you don't do that, then yes, they get frustrated and they'll be jumping around all over the place and they're not these things. But that's with most breeds, I would say.
But I mean, with labs, generally, they tend to have this problem with obesity, or, I mean, is it something that is like there with the dog as such, or is it that people don't really know how to take care of the breed when they're
It is. It is very fond of its food. Whatever you give it, it will just eat it. So yes, it is. It's very fond of its food. But that's also because how it was developed, basically. So it was a fisherman's dog. So over there, whatever scraps it got, it had to eat it to survive and be fit with that. So that's how I think it's come into its genes, that, you know, whatever it gets, it must eat it. And yes, it can put on a lot of weight if you don't monitor its diet. Don't feel, just today someone called me up and saying, oh, we feel very sorry for our dog. Now give him a little more food. But he's always looking at me with those eyes, with a lovely expression, kind eyes. I said, no, please don't get into that thing. You have to.
Yeah, I mean, that's a trap. That's basically a trap.
You put on too much weight and then they don't lose weight easily. So that's the thing.
Yeah, we that's true.
Beast dog, and it's not easy to make them lose. Just like humans, not easy to lose weight once you put on.
So, yeah. That's it. Yeah. Okay. Moving on to the next question, Mr. Dinkar. We've seen that, what are the colors that are there in the lab? I mean, since the most prevalent colors that you know, but I know that there's also a silver and a white, which is not actually permissible in the show rings as such. So can you shed some light on that?
Yeah. See, basically, as per the Kennel Club all over the world, there's only three colors which are permissible. There is a black, you have a yellow, and then you have a chocolate. There are only three colors which are there. You'd mentioned gray, I think. Silver color. See, again, this is not a recognized color. I'm sorry, this is not there. But what's happening is certain breeders, or actually in America, they develop this kind of colors to sell them, I think. Like, I also came to know about French bulldogs. They've come up with a lilac or a mauve color, which again is not there as per the standard. But they've got it there because then people think it's a unique color. Let's go buy it. So it's not there. It's not there in the standard, but yes.
But is it something new that that the silver and the white has been developed, or has it been there for quite some time?
No,
like, is it there in the gene pool or something else?
Silver's just been developed. See, I think the Waimiana or something, they've bred it to that. And they've set that silver color like that. So I think they've bred it to that kind of a dog and they've developed it. And see, but it's not a very popular color or something. You know, once in a while you might hear someone trying to sell off a silver colored Labrador, but otherwise it's not there. Like I said about the French bulldogs also, I came to know about this mauve color, which they're trying to sell it, or lilac, we call it. And they try and sell it with a much more premium price, saying that, you know, it's an exotic color kind of thing, but it's not there.
Okay.
Coming to your white Labradors thing. Now, basically, it's not white. Yellows has a lot of shades in it. There are a lot of shades in yellow. You get a dark shade, which you get a reddish, darkish shade, which get it with a lighter shade. So basically, it's a lighter shade which comes in. And the golden retrievers also in India, there's a couple of breeders who got these light color. I mean, call them white, you know, we can call them
white, exactly.
Or cream, because they're so white. I mean, they are. You can't call them a golden retriever. But yes, in Labradors, it has come in. And Russia, I feel, is the country which has actually really made it popular. So the whites were there, kind of white, also again yellows. I mean, it's a very faded yellow kind of a thing. But Russian breeders, I think, are really of late, in recent times, have really spread this color. And from Russia, you'll see a lot of dogs coming in which have this whitish color. There are two dogs in particular in America who, I mean, I have their pup also, but these two dogs, I've noticed the pitch and the dam, sire, which are in most of these pedigrees of these dogs, which are so-called white. or light yellow, but they're called white. They are there either together or separately. And I think they maybe have caused this color to have developed.
So the white is permissible inside the shoring. So just the silver, it's which not, is not basically.
It's not white, it's a shade of yellow.
Let me shade of yellow.
See, white is like an oxo, you have white, but that's a pigmentation problem. Which happens.
Yeah.
Nose and all that, they're pink noses. So that's a completely different thing. A pink nose is again lack of color, pigmentation, which can come also in your the mouth as well. When you see the color, it's different. But these Labradors, they're yellow. There's a shade of yellow, which are, as of now, shade of yellow. And they have the black pigmentation. There is no problem otherwise with them. And they are yellow. They're considered as yellow, not white. They're yellow like this.
They'll be yellow.
A light shade of yellow.
Lighter shade of yellow.
Yes, they look like white, like I said, like a golden retriever. We do have these, which look like cream and thing, but this is, I mean, it's still called a golden retriever, but golden become kind of white.
But yeah, I mean, I think I had this question when I was talking to Mr. Preetam about goldens, because I told him that, nowadays you don't see them as golden at all. Like, they're more of whites than the goldens that are actually getting shown, because there's no golden anymore, which is actually golden. So golden
that's one of the problems, actually, because in dogs now it's become a fashion. You see, something catches up and everyone wants it. So like I said,
India,
a lot of people say, I want a white. They don't understand it's a yellow, but it's a very pale yellow kind of thing. But they say, no, I want a white Labrador. Do you have a white Labrador or white Labrador pup? And we've imported a lot of dogs coming in from Russia. So yes, they're all kind of white, if you may call
them. Whitish,
yeah. So they are yellow and so it's become popular now. A lot of people want the white.
Okay. You said about the expression. So the expression comes from the head. So is it fair enough to call a Labrador the head breed, like how you call the Dane or the Boxer or such?
No, not really. I mean, a Boxer, yes, but not here in the case of a Labrador. You would need to understand the Labrador and why it was developed or how it was developed. See, now a lot of people say Labrador. I'll explain a bit about it, so then we come to know in the end, we come back to the head. It's not really a head breed, but you have to see the total dog together, and that's what it is. So, the Labrador is not an English breed like most people know that it's an English breed. It was in Newfoundland, Canada, and there was an island called St. John, if I remember correctly, and that's where these dogs were being used, and they are water dogs, basically. There are these fishermen off the coast. They used to go fishing these small boats of theirs. And they needed a dog, which was a medium-sized dog, which could sit in their boat, go with them into the rough seas or into the sea off the coast. And then they used to throw nets to catch these cod. The cod fishermen, cod is a fish, to get these, catch these fish. And the nets had to be drawn in. So they required a dog, which is a medium-sized dog, but a strong dog, which would go in, swim, and pull the nets in. If some fish escaped from the nets, he could go and retrieve it. Now, based on this, there are a few qualities which the dog had to have. Like I said, it had to be medium sized because it could come into the boat. If it's too heavy or big, you won't be able to pull it into the boat. It had to have a coat, a unique coat. The coat has to be a short coat, but a double coated coat, because the water is very icy cold. So it had to have an inner coat which would protect it, keep it warm, and an outer coat, which was kind of a waterproof coat, which right now, if you see a lab, put water on them, wipe them with a towel, it more or less goes off. It doesn't get wet or entangled and things like that. It's a water-resistant kind of a coat, harshish coat, I could feel. So that, again, they wanted that. So I had to be a strong, muscular dog to swim in the water and go and get the fish or pull the nets into the thing. Another thing over here comes is the mouth, which is very unique. It has to have a soft mouth, because when it went and fetched the fish, the cod fish is quite big, but it should not put its teeth into it. See, if the teeth went into the cod fish, the fish would get damaged. The fishermen would not be able to sell the fish. So that's again a unique quality of the Labrador, to have a soft mouth. So the coat comes in and the mouth comes in. Now the tail, again, which is very high. I mean, everyone's thinking about the tail, the otter tail. Now the otter tail in the water acts like a rudder. Like in the boat, you have a rudder at the back, which you can take direction. That's a nice, strong, thickly wrapped tail, which again acted like a rudder for the
Labrador. For the dog,
So these are, in a way, these are the kind of standards also of the breed, which are coming in when I speak. And then, like I said, it's a medium-sized, muscular, strong dog, which had to do this. The otter tail came in. The coat has come in. The uniqueness of the thing is the coat and the otter tail and a short sleeve. It's also a short coupled dog. If it's too long, it would not be able to move with the water. The legs had to be right under it so it can paddle and it can go. And for long time, it could swim. You see a swimmer, typical swimmer, if you see, he's a chiseled person. You know, there's no fat or any flab on the guy. He's a muscular, not really muscular, but athletic person. Similarly, a Labrador has no fat or any flab around it. It had to be like that. The head, like we had, you'd ask me about the head. But the head had to be a medium-sized head. So if you have a very large, chunky head, and you're swimming, and you have picked up a fish or in land, a duck or so, a pheasant, too much weight, it would just go down. So again, it's like a boat. The Labrador should be looked as a boat. So if it had too much weight in front, it would just go into the water. It would not be able to swim. So it had to have a medium-sized head, a square, kind of a square muzzle, a strong squarish muzzle, broad square muzzle, because it had to have the strength to hold the fish or prey and bring it back. Okay. So that again, the muzzle comes in. There should be no cheeks, fleshiness in the cheeks. It should be a smooth thing. So we see, so the water is aerodynamic. So when it's moving in the water, the snout there, the water just goes off. So if there's anything with a blocky head, for example, the water, it would take more energy to push itself and go through. So it becomes aerodynamic by having that kind of a head. The front, again, when viewed, the Labrador typically should be like an arrow. When you view it from the back, it should be like an arrow. When I say about like an arrow, I mean, when you see the head and everything, at the back, it has to be wider. Like again, you see the boat, it's wider at the back and the middle as compared to the front. The front is tapering. Why? Because then it can go through the water and thing. Again, forechest of the dog is very important in a Labrador. When it has a forechest, the water gets parted away and it can move ahead. See, if you had a flat-chested dog, it can't go through the water. It had to put more energy. So it gets wasted. So it needs less energy, but it can keep moving and doing its work. So that's the reason where the forechest comes in and the breastbone in front comes in, which just spreads the water, like I said, in a boat, compare it to the boat, and the dog goes ahead. Now, this, we come down to the body. It has to have a good spring of ribs. So it needs a lot of lung room, and for the heart, it should be there for it to work continuously in water.
In water, yeah.
Yes. Again, the chest and the ribs should not be like a bachelor or barrel shape, because a barrel again is unstable. If you see a round barrel put into water, it goes topsy-turvy. It's not stable. So the thing typically should be an oval-shaped thing, so that the gravity takes care of it. It stays on top. It's floating in the water. The withers, which is the shoulder, top of the shoulder, to the elbow, that distance, and from the elbow to the ground, that distance should be equal. Short coupled, so it is like a compact, slightly off-square dog. So again, all these things help for it to move in water and be stable and stay above the water. It doesn't just sink down. If it's too heavy a dog, it'll just sink down. And if it's too wide a dog, it won't be able to move in the water. Again, it takes too much energy and effort to move ahead. Typically, in front, between the forelegs, our hands' width should be there between the two legs in front. Yeah. It should not be more than that. A lot of dogs, you see, are very wide in the chest. Again, we don't want that in the Labrador. It is happening, but we don't want it. Just a little hand should be between two legs. That's what
the distance should be.
That's what
I think. You have some pictures also that you wanted to show me, right?
Yes, I'll show that also to you. So that gives you a better understanding of the entire dog and the. Now, this is a lovely dog. I hope you can see the picture, Sudhak.
Yeah. It's just kind of make it a little bigger. You can just make this photo a little bigger.
Yeah, there you go. Now, this is a very nice dog, which is there. Again, an English dog. Now, here you can see the forechest, the importance of the forechest, and that bone which comes out of the breastbone, which comes out, how it just parts the water and can move ahead like a boat, like I mentioned to you.
Yeah.
See the reach of neck. So that is very important for a dog also to see, to pick up a bird or the fish. The reach of neck is very important. Okay. The head has to be in balance with the body. It can't be too big a head as compared to the body. It has to be in balance. Look at the muzzle. It has to be a strong muzzle, a broad, strong muzzle.
Yeah.
Then the lay of shoulders. Again, that plays a very important role also when the bird is on ground, dog is on the ground and goes to fetch a bird. That helps in picking up the bird and then coming back effortlessly. See, if the lay of shoulders too up, it will have problems. That will stop and then pick up the bird. So the lay of shoulder, the way it is, it's very important in the dog. Now the shoulder and the upper arm, if you see, it comes like a triangle, and both should be equal.
Okay.
The shoulder length and the upper arm length.
Shoulder length and upper arm. Yeah.
Just behind the front legs, that if you make a line, it becomes a triangle over there. That's how the front of the angulation of your should be. The coat, like I mentioned, it should be a double coat, weather resistant. Undercoat, which protects it, keeps it warm. The typical otter tail, which is a thickly wrapped tail, the typical length of that should come to the hocks of the dog, not longer than that.
Not longer than that.
Then comes the snipple, which is basically the joint of the back leg, if you see. It has to be turned, well turned in. And the hocks, well let down into the hocks. Hocks should not be very high. It should be shorter, the hocks. If you see the thigh from the side, which you're seeing the thigh, it's a nice broad, it's a broad muscular thigh.
Muscular thigh, yes.
And the second thigh also is very important. A lot of dogs lack that. The second thigh is also very important. Again, in the water, like I mentioned, at the back, like pistons, they go forward, backward like that, and that's going to give the power to the dog while it's in the water. So that is very important. When you look at the dog from the back, again, it should be broad. The thigh should be broad. It's showing you muscle and strength. So the hinds have to be very strong, not weak.
Exactly.
It's not just the front. See, it's all together. It's a machine which works together. The front as well as the rear. So that is again very important. I don't like dogs which are too square. I prefer them a slightly longer in length for a simple reason. When they are on the move, when they are moving, if it's too square dog, I feel the legs, the front of the legs come and bang, they bang inside. And the dog then starts moving sideways. He starts moving sideways and again spoils the whole image of the dog. So I feel it is slightly longer as compared to the thing, rather than being a very compact and very squarish dog, slightly longer than the square is the what I personally prefer. And I feel that is a better way of working with the dog. So that should have explained to you that, you know, you can't just say it's a head breed or it's a thing. So you have to look at the breed in totality of what this dog was developed for and how it moves. It should have good reach also and drive, but not too much. It should cover sufficient ground, but it's not like the other sporting dogs which fly on land because they're a land dog. So they just have to move, cover a lot of area like this. But this is not a land dog. This is a water dog. So it has to keep its energies, yet be efficient in moving and work throughout the day. So the movement of this dog is different as compared to them. You cannot compare them. A lot of people compare them and say, you know, reach and drive should be a hell of a lot of reach and drive. But I'm sorry, this dog, it's not there. It's just the power, the backs, like pistons, the legs should move back and forth and work. I'll show you another picture which would help. There you go. So when it's in movement, you could see the dog how it moves, but not too much reach and drive, but yet it's covering sufficient area, unlike some of the, said, some of the other gun dogs and things, which have
where the movement, where the drive is more. Yeah, you said for this, the drive is not basically what the strength of the dog, the strength of the hind legs is what is actually important for this dog.
Yes, that is what you need to keep in mind. Thing and the dog in totality. I mean, you can't just pick up one thing and say that is it. I'll just show you the boat one also.
Yeah,
here's what I was mentioning. If you see below there. The one which is on my right, I guess, from the side also.
I think you can move your screen as well. I mean, you can move your mouse pointer so that you can point out which one you're talking about.
This is the correct dog, like I was mentioning to you. See, it's like a boat shape. In front, it's tapering in front and becoming wide. So it can just go through the water. Aerodynamics, like in cars, you have that thing, the bonnets are down in sports cars. Because you just tear through the air and go faster.
It's got to start out lean and broaden as it goes at the back as such.
Yes, so the chest should not be very broad. Some dogs are there. And like I said, a medium-sized head, a strong muzzle, a squarish strong muzzle, so it can pick up things. And this tears through the water and goes. See the hinds over here, they work parallel to each other with great power and muscle to push and propel a dog which goes ahead. And in the middle here, the correct one, if you see it from the front, here are your front legs. You can see the hind legs, they are slightly broader and they're out because the dog is at the back is slightly wider.
That's Yeah, something else is also.
These again, some it should be parallel. The muzzle and the head here should be parallel. That's the correct one. Should not be snipey. Okay. The muzzle. Right, to go. Yeah. You can't have a coarse dog like this. It's not a Rottweiler or something. Don't have this. In here, you can see it's sloping, so it's incorrect.
Yeah.
Here again,
the stop is not something.
Yeah, it's like a dish shape, like
it's a more pointer. like a dish shape, more of a pointer. Yeah, exactly.
Kind of thing. So again, that's wrong. This is what it should be parallel here. You see things. This is how the head should be of the Labrador. Now, I mean, I'll just briefly just go through these slides so you can see it. Now again, the bite, which I think most people know about it, but the bite is the scissor bite, like we all know. Then you have a level bite. Now, in the UK, it has to be a scissor bite. In the US, you see the standard for the Labrador is the same in all countries, more or less. There's slight variations. So the bite comes into play. I mean, in the UK, it is just a scissor bite. In the US, it is a scissor bite, but a level bite is permissible. A lot of people tell me, no, a level bite, not there. But I say, in the US, it's permissible. Then the incorrect undershot and overshot, those are not at all things.
Yeah, that's completely true.
But another thing which I'd like to also mention is missing premolars.
Yes, see, I think there's a question also about missing premolars that has been asked by one gentleman. Are missing premolars allowed in shows? If how many
soft mouth? Yeah, more or less the same thing. That's what I'm going to mention. See, again, the standards, the UK standard really doesn't mention much about the missing premolars. The FCI and the US does. They want full teeth there. They don't want anything missing. Dentition. But again, you need to go and see the development of breed and what the breed is all about. This breed has a soft mouth and it is used to retrieve game. When I say game, it can be hare, it can be pheasants, it can be ducks. In Newfoundland, this thing was for fish, is to retrieve. It's a soft mouth, so you don't want to damage whatever it's retrieving back. A pheasant or a duck, if you damage the teeth, go into it, the thing has got damaged, you're not going to eat that bird or so. It's useless. Same thing as a fish, which I mentioned. If it damages it, no one's going to buy. Again, like I mentioned, the UK standard doesn't mention much about it, but I've spoken to a lot of breeders over there. What they say is, a lot of champion dogs, good dogs in the UK have missing premolars. So it's no big deal. I mean, you might have it, you will not be penalized for it. And if it's a good dog, he will win. But in the US, unfortunately, they want all the teeth there. It's a missing premolar. Sorry, not there.
Sorry.
But
no,
IP,
the American standard.
Yeah. But then again, in America also, I've spoken to breeders who just go to specialty shows. And that's what they say, that again, there, it's not a big deal. So in all
in breed the specialty shows, it's not a big deal. In the all breed shows.
Yeah, because again, America is quite it's interesting, but the breeders who are really into Labradors, they will not take their dogs to all breed shows. They will generally stick to their Potomac and the specialty shows. That is it, because over there they are seeing these traits, which a Labrador is a Labrador. It is not some other breed. And that's what it should judge also. In an all breed judge show also, it should be done that way. But unfortunately, it's not being done. I think a lot of all breed judges, I mean, no offense, but they talk about, they see just movement, and these things, no teeth, sorry, out you go, premolar is missing, out you go. But I feel that's incorrect, not right. Stick to these other qualities for which the breed was.
Dog was actually bred to do.
Yeah. Tail set is again a very important thing, which I would like to mention. See, the tail should just go off the back, straight off the back. And when he's moving,
it's an extension of the spine, basically.
I'm sorry?
It's an extension of the spine. That's what they generally...
Yeah, but this goes off the, off the back. It should not be carried up, like you see this over here. This is a gay tail. A gay tail is not... I mean, sperm is this thing, but I don't like it. I don't think gay tails are good. They're coming up like that, like a beagle. Tail comes right up there. It should just go off. That's the right tail. A lot of dogs have a curl. If you see here, this curling up. Unfortunately, I have seen dogs like this, and they have also won in shows. But again, I think that is incorrect. But then again, some like all breed judges, so everyone can't be an expert on a breed. So that's where the issue comes in, I feel. But again, no offense to anyone. But a little more care should be taken regarding these smaller details and should not be utilized for that. The front. Now, another thing which I had spoken earlier was the front angulation when we are describing the boat and the thing that the dog is built like a boat. Here you have the correct angulation, 90 degrees. There's a shoulder, here's the upper arm. A straight line to drop it down, it should come right behind here. And this is there. The forechest comes in.
Can you make the picture slightly bigger? Like kind of small for
yeah. So here you go. So when you have the right things, you will get your forechest also coming in. But okay. Here if the shoulder lays these two upright. It's not there. Right. The forechest automatically there.
Yeah.
The dog is also gonna have a problem picking up the bird. It's right up there. So you know, it's like a crane movement. So when it's back, it can pick up the thing and bring it back. But it gets an issue when it's too much, it's too steep a shoulder. Here again, lay of shoulder is nice, but the upper arm is too short in here. Short. So again, no fore chest, it's not a good thing, it's wrong over there. Again, the rear angulation, there has to be a bend and stipple coming down. Hawks should be here. And dogs lack the bend and stipple, the straight stipple is not there. So there are different things which are wrong. The correct one is this one, which is there. The angulation has to be right. It has to be a bend and good thing coming to the hawks. Hawks have to be here, straight and short hawks, not long hawks, which is happening in some dogs. You have to find very briefly the feet. You see, this is the incorrect foot of a thing. This is what the correction should be, tight and right there. Right. Not a cat, not like a cat foot, some more like a Doberman thing. No, this is the one which is correct. And that is how it should be. I think I'm more or less everything has been covered. One last when you get to back. This is what people should look like, look for, and this is what I said is a beautiful dog. Bred by John and Sordia from Barrion Weathertop. They've left the entire life they've spent with dogs. John passed away, unfortunately, with long illness. And, but yeah, so this is what one should look for in a
good, perfect.
I think we can move on to the next question if you like.
We have actually a couple of questions in regards to the standards. So, asked by one, Sir Radhakrishnan Swaminathan. Are soft offline caused due to genetic traits or due to rearing?
I think this is a genetic thing, not really due to rearing this thing. Wearing top lines is a genetic thing, not this thing.
Soft top lines is more of a...
Rearing issues which happen in Labrador, what I feel is more in the pasterns and the hawks which happen, which puppies are not raised properly. That's where the issues come in. Hard
but the soft offline is more of a genetic issue passed on by
it's not I don't think this is for a rearing thing, it's a genetic thing. If the father genetic. And mother have good top lines, the pups are going to be having good top lines as well. It's not going to be you haven't reared it properly because of which the top line has gone.
Okay, moving on to the next question, Dinkar. What are the common health ailments prevalent with the Labrador Retriever? Are they specific all testing available to screen breeding stocks? As such, the facilities available in India. Are these facilities actually available in India?
The Labrador, basically, I would say the health issues would be the elbows and the hips and the eyes. These are things which should be tested. As far as testing facilities goes, unfortunately, I feel there are lack of facilities, but the southern states of India are very forward, I would say, and I think there are certain places where this has started happening, and maybe it would catch up in up north as well. But yes, breeding stock should be screened. It is very important to be screened. Again, I would like to mention, which I came to know recently, in a country there's a popular breed. Again, I won't mention names and breeds. The popular breed, there was a top winning show dog there. He was barely 4 years old, and he just died. Being a top show dog, he was used by dozens of bitches, produced pups, some are going to produce, some are already there on ground, some are preparing for the show ring, and this dog is top dead. Now, what's happened is, this dog had disease, an ailment or a health ailment which is there. And the person responsible hasn't got it checked or knew about it yet, let these dogs
then be.
The breeder who's actually produced this dog or bred this dog knows that there's this issue in their lines, yet they're breeding and selling dogs, pups, to overseas countries as well as in the US as well. But here what I'm saying, health testing is a must. See what's happened now with this particular breed, because there's so many dogs which have been bred to this particular sire, and now all of them are going to have this issue. They're all going to be kicking it, hopefully. I'm not hopefully, but they would eventually have a shorter life and they would die with this disease. If they get, if they're used by some other people, in turn, it's going to further spread. So it's like a COVID. It's going to spread to that entire breed. They're going to finish that entire breed. It's very sad. But that entire breed can finish off because of one irresponsible testing not done. So I feel testing is very important. People should take it seriously. If you can get it done, you must get it done. Or you must know your dogs and your pedigree very well. And know your dogs and your pedigree very well, you know exactly what's there in those dogs. Even if you don't have the health testing, at least you know each and every dog and that they are health tested and they're free. So hopefully the dogs that you have, they are fine and the pups will be fine also. But if there's a health issue, you should not breed those dogs for monetary reasons, for whatever reason, you shouldn't. Like I said, this breed is can finish off. I mean, it's like COVID, which is spread in this particular breed in this particular country. Very sad.
But I mean, we don't have these facilities here available in India, do we?
Unfortunately, I feel they're not. I might be incorrect, but they're coming in. I mean, there are good veterinary clinics opening up every day I see in the northern states, southern states. So it will slowly, slowly come in. And it would be a good thing if they come in. People should test it. And if there is an issue, they should not breed those dogs. Because it's heartbreaking for anyone taking it, spending so much time and money, whether it's for showing, whether it's a pet home. And then something happens and the dog dies early, it's heartbreaking.
No. But with this dog, as I said, being with this dog, even hip HD, the hip dysplasia, I think this is also one of the major issues that you see, that you face with labs, right?
See, again, if they are bred properly, there would be no issue. But if you haven't bred them properly or if you haven't got them tested, yes, it can creep in and yes, it can be genetic.
And genetic. Be,
so then you have to be careful.
Okay. We have a question about ACL. Mr. Radhakrishnan asked the same question. Can you talk about ACL issues which is seem to be rampant in certain countries? This is called by nature or nature?
What is ACL? What is ACL? I'm sorry, I'm
but good. Okay, I think ACL is one. I think ACL is this.
Again, he'll have to expand on that. I mean, what exactly is this ligament rupture which he's talking about? I mean, is it something which happens to puppies? Is it that is that the thing he's talking about, or it has in general to Labrador? Because I haven't heard of it. I mean, a veterinary would be better to show put light on it and be done.
Yeah, maybe Mr. Radhakrishnan, if you can just shed some more light on what exactly you want, maybe Mr. Zinkar will be able to answer that question as such. Okay, there's one another person who's asked about skin problems. I mean, this is something that you see with the dog as well. Is it like, is it more, again, genetic or, I don't think it's genetic, is it?
So that's the thing is, see, if it's a well-bred dog, you would not have issues. And what happens with skin issues, what I see commonly is, people tend to give baths every week, you know, too often. You bathe them too often. That's it. See, there are some necessary oils in the coat of any dog. And Labrador in particular does have that to keep himself waterproof. But if you bathe them too often, those oils will go off. Once those oils go off, it protects the skin and the coat. It is bound to have allergies and things like that. So you have to bathe them less. I mean, like I said, it's an easy dog to keep. So if it's not dirty, don't bathe it. If you just brush it once or twice a week, it's clean. If it gets some dirt, if you brush it, it all falls off. Take a towel, just wipe him. He'll be clean. So try and avoid frequent bathing. It's not good. I at times in winters don't bathe my dogs for two months. And they're not smelling. They're fine. They're lying around. There's no problem.
Okay.
As long as you're brushing them and all the dirt and things have just come off, there's no problem. But if you do frequent bathing, then yes, issues will come up in Labradors and in other breeds as well. Because the essential oils from the coat go off.
Generally go off.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, our next question is about basically coat maintenance. You actually answered the question as well. Can you share a thought on this other coat types and tips on good coat maintenance? How much appropriate coat maintenance is dependent on the natural environment of the
dog? Lab is a very easy dog to keep. I mean, like I said, once a week, just brush him and you'll be fine. Nutrients are not really required as such to give them. If you're feeding them a good premium food, it has everything in it. You don't need to give any supplements or anything for the coat. It is fine. In winters, perhaps you could give some cod liver oil or something like that, and that would help further with the coat. But otherwise, I feel there is nothing else which is required for giving the coat to become better or so. I mean, if you just take care of it, like I said, not go too frequent bathing, groom them, probably keep brushing them. They do shed. I've noticed yellows seem to shed throughout the year. Black seem to shed less. But so if you keep brushing them, combing their hair, I'm not combing, brushing their hair, and get a slicker brush that helps in taking out the undercoat when it's shedding twice a year or so. And that would help. And yeah, nothing else would be required. And the brush itself massages the skin, so it's good for the skin and for the follicles, hair follicles, and gets a better coat. So yes, you have to brush it off. Do it regularly. There should be no problem.
We have one question in regards to the working line and the show line. I mean, what's the difference between the working and the show Labradors in the show dogs work in real life? Does the show dog work in real life?
Yeah, the show dog can work in, if it's, like I said, if it's constructed and built properly, like I mentioned initially to you, like the boat thing, which I keep going back to you because that's how it was built. If the dog is built properly, there would be no issues. It can work throughout the day and there would be no issues. But if it's not built properly, then yes, it would not be able to do it. I mean, like I mentioned all the points earlier and we were discussing it. Those are all there in your dog. There's no problem. As far as the working lines and show dog, like I said, if the show dog is constructed properly, he would work perfectly fine. But yes, I have noticed that some of the working lines, like you see in also German Shepherds, the working lines in the German Shepherd show dogs are slightly different. But here there's no top line problem or anything of the sort like you see in German Shepherds. But what happens here, I've seen they're slightly leaner, the leggier dogs, which are the working lines. I did once get a video from the UK regarding how to train your dog for gun purpose because my grandfather used to do it, so I just got intrigued. I said, let's have a look. But those dogs which I saw, which were being bred, they were quite, not quite different, but they're slightly different. Like I said, they are leaner. Those dogs were leaner and they're more leggier dogs. They did not have so much muscle and substance for whatever reason. But that's what I saw in this particular video. It might be wrong. The other ones might be there. But because in England, they're regularly using Labradors for this kind of work. They have regular pheasant shoots and people pay a lot of money. And you have dogs which go and fetch the pheasants, bring them back. They are duck shoots as well. They go into the water and bring them. But mostly pheasant. So I guess the dog is not required to be that strong. It's more on the land, like I mentioned, other gun dogs which will just float on the land and go flying, covering more ground. So because of which maybe they are leggier dogs and less substance and muscle on them.
Okay. Right. So they are. So there is a difference in the show line as well as the in the working line. Like I said, like they're more leaner and they're more.
If you search even in America, I've seen some when you search working lines, you will see these are leaner dogs which are there. And leggier dogs, which are they using for those things? Now, whether they are at working lines, or but they are, have been developed and they are using them like that.
Perfect. Mr. Radhakrishnan had actually come back to us in regards to what he wanted to know. His question is more in specific to knee injury, something called elbow dysplasia. I mean, are you ACL is what is all about?
See, I haven't experienced this. Like I said, I think a veterinarian would be able to help you better. But what I have experienced, and what I'll tell you, see, a Labrador grows very quickly from 3 months to 5 months, and from 5 months to 8 months, there are these growth spurts, which they grow very quickly. They do have, at times, pain and issues in their joints because they're so rapidly growing. So what I've noticed is if you give vitamin C, which again, consult your vet, not just take my thing, vitamin C, it helps with those pains and aches. I was also seeing recently a program and I asked a physiotherapist about, and she was a veterinarian also. It's called floating lameness, which again, puppies get it because again, like I said, the spurt in the growth, they're growing very fast because of which one leg might be limping in the one day or for a few days and the next one and the next one, it can happen. I haven't experienced it, but yes, I've experienced that at times one of the legs might feel a little uncomfortable. it might look like, yes, the dog is in a little bit of a pain or so. But like I said, because they're growing rapidly, the pups, you know, vitamin C, which I generally give, I see that helps in that pain and they become perfectly fine. But anything more serious here also, you should consult a veterinarian because they will have a better idea. I would not have a clue on what kind of lines you have, what are your dogs, and what kind of issues they may be having or carrying forward.
Okay. Moving on to the next question. The recent trend shows that there is a lot of untypical, very heavy coarse dogs being placed in the breed/group residential lineup. Do you agree that such a trend is prevalent? And if so, why so?
Again, I mean, no disrespect to anyone or so, but yes, I do agree this is happening. Like I mentioned earlier to you, it is also fashion which comes in. One dog starts winning and everyone says, now let's use this dog. And that dog passes it on to its offspring and people think that's the correct Labrador. And the whole breed at times gets ruined or it's gone.
Okay.
Again, the problem also comes in with, again, I mean no disrespect, but some judges who are new and they are not Labrador specialists, so they haven't kept Labradors. They've kept maybe other dogs and other groups and things. And they don't have that much knowledge about that particular breed, like the Labrador, because of which they may place some dogs which they see that the handler is a famous handler or so, or the owner is supposed to be a famous big breeder. So just because he's got that dog in, should be a good dog, let's place him so that no one questions. And again, I mean, no disrespect. I mean, I'm not saying everyone is doing it. But yes, you have odd people, some of these guys, I mean, very few, would do such a thing, because of which those dogs start getting placed. Once they start getting placed, automatically start going up into lineups and things. And people think this is the right dog. Like I said, I was once showing my dog and there was a dog competing with him who had a coarse head. I mean, it had a Rottweiler, short muzzle, tail curled over the back. Yet this dog won in the all breed show. In the specialty, my dog came best in show. But that's what I'm saying. I mean, it depends on the judge. If it's a specialty judge, he would understand and know what is good, what is not correct. I think, but an all breed judge, especially a new one at times, does get confused. They don't know what they're doing. And this issue can happen. And once it creeps in, there is an issue. Now, some breeders in America are breeding some Labradors, which are lovely dogs, but they're not Labradors. I mean, you can call them anything else, but Labradors. And they're lovely dogs. But they've changed it, you know. There'll be a big head. It's like a Rottweiler. You can call them Rottweilers. They're too big. Big heads. The expression has changed. You know, that sweet melting expression is not there in the dog. It's changed. It's not a Labrador. So then this is how things change. And unfortunately, you get the wrong type of dogs, like you mentioned in this question. And they start getting promoted. Yeah. And then in turn, a lot of newcomers or people who are not really that knowledgeable, they think that's the right kind of a Labrador. Let's breed to that. They have pups. It just carries on. It's a vicious circle. And you get trapped into it. And there you go.
Oh, nice. Okay. Perfect. So we have another question. Is the dog, I think I'm just trying to search for the question. There's one gentleman asked whether if the dog is a wet type or a dry type dog. Is Labrador considered as a wet or a dry?
What do you mean by a wet and a dry dog?
The breed dry in type or wet?
I'm sorry?
Dry in the coarseness, I think. Is that? We'll go on to the next question. That's like much more easier. Okay. You have seen a lot of labs in the span of time that you have been reading and showing. So what do you think has influenced the current crop of dogs that has actually been shown in the ring right now? Be it a good, be it a bad dog, as such. So which are the dogs that actually had the influence right now?
Again, I mean no disrespect to anyone. But unfortunately, I don't know why India is a country obsessed with importing, which I keep bringing up the question in your thing also. Why are we so obsessed with just importing dogs? We are importing dogs and left, right and center. We're not really looking into the pedigrees of the dogs. So like Marion Hopkins, I mean, from Rockabilly, she had come in to the seminar and she said a similar thing also. She said, India has all the bloodlines possible in your country. You have all the dogs. You've imported from all over the world, all the kennels possible. You've got them everywhere there. But now you need to start working on those things. You can't just keep importing dogs. So you've got to look at the pedigrees and start working on those dogs. Once you start seeing the pedigrees and you do some line breeding, you see what you're doing. See an outcross, which what's happening right now, I see, again, no offense to anyone, is mostly outcrossing. When you do an outcross, it's basically hitting out in the dark. You don't know what you're going to get. I mean, fine, the dogs, you might like this dog, you might like this dog, pair them together. But what are you going to get? You have no idea. So you do have to look at the pedigrees and see, do they have any similar dogs in their pedigrees? Are they the same type which you're trying to breed and get out of it? What are you eventually trying to gain? So I feel that is there, which again is lacking. A lot of dogs have come in. Unfortunately, there's another thing. A good show dog is not necessarily becomes a good stud dog. So, you know, you may have got a lot of good dogs coming into the country, but I really don't see more than a generation or two of any dog which is there and is really produced well. I mean, we have a huge number of dogs called this champion, that champion, but have they really left their mark in our country on the Labradors? I don't think so. I mean, they're not good producers. And I guess that's why the breeders let them go, because they haven't really produced well. So that's another thing which one has to look in, that a good show dog is not necessarily a good stud dog. So you have to see a dog which is producing what he has. And he's reproducing it again and again and again. That's a good stud dog. And that is what you should be using if you, that's what you like and that's what you want to further go ahead with. That is what you should be looking at. Unfortunately, I mean, that's not really happening here. So, yeah. It's just,
I mean, what you said is also vice versa. Not all good stud dogs are actually also show dogs. I mean, the male can actually be a good producer, but not necessarily that he might show well inside the ring or something like that.
True. So that is an issue which is coming. I mean, there's a lovely dogs which have been imported into the country, no doubt. There's some lovely dogs. I mean, there's so many of them, even in the world or in India, which have come in. It's not right to mention one or two dogs, because there's so many of them which are lovely dogs. But like I mentioned, they haven't really left their mark. Whoever the dog has been, I haven't really seen a dog which has really left his mark here. He's dead and gone, but his mark is still there in the show scene. I really don't see that. I don't see any lines, kennel lines still in India, I mean, I guess for Labradors, and I guess that is the main reason. I mean, otherwise you should work with the dogs which you have, the lines which you have, there you go, you have your kennel type which is coming, but I don't see that happening also. So
leaving India abroad, so what do you think where the dogs would actually influence the breed to being this popular in the world scenario?
Which dogs have influenced? Again, there's so many of them that, again, it's very difficult to just name one or two. I mean, they have the kennels. For example, you have Dickendale, which is a very popular kennel. And they've done some lovely work. They're working with Sonia, which is Belmare Kennels in Poland. And she's also helped me a lot with mentoring me. And they seem to be producing some nice dogs as well. But there's so many of them. I mean, there's High Spears there. There are two. I mean, like in Australia, there's this lady... Glenys McClaw, something like that. She, I think, has lovely dogs. New Zealand, there's another lady. I think she's got lovely dogs. So there are a lot of people with these lovely dogs, and they are going to leave their mark there. It's very difficult to put a number or this, can't say. There are so many of them. Labrador being a popular breed, there are a huge number of things. Like, I'll give you a simple example. There's a kennel called Devonshire. Now, that kennel was really not really known till I got my dog from there. Not trying to boast. I bought a puppy. I never wanted to get adult dogs. I mean, for various reasons. I bought a puppy, but whatever happened, dog came later to me. And I really scanned and looked into the parents' pedigrees, everything. I got this dog in. Now, the parents of this dog, you would see either together or differently in most of the pedigrees of the Russian dogs. And they are the world dog show winner and all that stuff that you have. You'll have a Devonshire dog there, and all coming from Devonshire Limited Edition or Devonshire Darjeeling. Both American champions, nice dogs. And they're the parents of my dog, but they will see them. So that dog left a mark. So you see a Devonshire everywhere. So that kennel has left a mark. It's a small kennel. But at the same time, there are lots of large, like I said, Dickendales there. So many larger kennels, so many kennels which you may not have heard of, I may not have heard, but they are leaving their mark. So it's not right to just put in a number of say this, that is it. A good kennel. You know, there are a lot of kennels. Like I said, the New Zealand ladies, lovely dogs. The Australian lady again has lovely dogs. So there's so many.
You were talking about, I mean, you were saying like there are a lot of people importing dogs and for a lot of reasons as such. But okay, the breed standards, we are talking about, we have a next question that's about the otter tail. And you already spoken about the tail placement and what actually the otter tail is all about.
I actually missed out another thing of the otter tail. You see, the base of the tail of a Labrador is really nice and thick. So it's as thick as your wrist. So if you hold it there, it's really thick and wide. So, I mean, that's another thing which has to be there. It's tightly wrapped around. The tail is tightly wrapped around and comes down to a little point. At times, the hair goes up. So in the shows, we cut it off. Like I said, but that's the main otter tail which is there. It should go to the hocks, not longer than that. And that's the basic otter tail. Like I said, when it moves, it should go off the back. Shouldn't curl up, come up or anything of the sort. And that is what the otter tail is. And it's used like a rudder. Hence, it is so solid and it bangs around. It does hit you in the house if it's wagging its tail. But that's what typical otter tail is. And like I said, a rudder in the thing. So that is why it was developed. And that is how it was the otter tail. And if you have they say if you have a correct otter tail in a dog, generally the other things will also fall in and they should all be corrected. That's what the saying is. I don't know how much correct it is, but yeah.
But unfortunately, you don't see the otter tails in the show rings. There's something that I have seen in labs. My remembrance of labs, or rather, in the sense, was Pati, Mr. Pati. I think he had some really good labs when he was showing in his heydays, and I have actually seen his dogs having otter tails. But in the recent past, I don't think I've actually seen many dogs actually have this characteristics in the ring. So why? What has actually happened?
Yeah, they're feathered or they're not saying, they're not tightly wrapped around like it should typically be. It's not like that. But again, it goes down to breeding. See, there's so many things which are there. Like I said, again, I mentioned John and Saudi Arabia, they're very close to me and they helped me a lot, mentoring me. And like they used to rightly say, they spent the entire life developing the head of them. They have beautiful, the Darien Weathertop is the kennel name. You know, they no longer breed now because she's too old. And like I said, John passed away. But beautiful head, they spent their entire life doing that. So, I mean, it takes a long time and you have to have that dedication and concentration of what exactly do you want to do. It's not just breeding a pup and selling it off or giving placing or just a close win. You've got to see what you want and it takes time. I mean, it takes time. I mean, it takes this thing. I mean, if you want to be a breeder or something, you should at least breed 3-4 generations of your own bred dogs, make them champions. That is an achievement. I mean, in a way, I would feel that. I mean, just getting a dog and making it best in show, you know. So I really don't think that would be an achievement for me, at least. I don't know for others. But yeah, you have to concentrate on what exactly do you want.
Developing the breed, exactly.
Yeah, but that's why we're going haywire. I mean, a lot of people go haywire, not just India. A lot of people go haywire. So if you have your things all there, what you want, ultimately, you want, and yeah, what's lacking in your dog?
I mean, even if you're importing a dog, get the right type, right? The breed, get the right breed type, exactly. For you to improve the lines here, not just.
Yeah, the breed type basically is what makes a Labrador, you know?
Yeah.
Like you mentioned earlier, those are the traits. It should have all those things. If it's got all that thing, it's a level top line. It's not a sloping top line. I see dogs with a sloping top line. I'm sorry, a Labrador is not a
sloping. Like they're not like Dobermans.
They're flowing, head up, you know? Labrador, again, I might not have mentioned earlier. It's not supposed to keep its head up like that and move like a setter or something of the sort. It's slightly forward. Again, like I said, the boat thing, when it's in the water, it has to have his head ahead to tear the water apart and move ahead, you know. So you have to see the why and how it was developed, for what purpose. Any breed, I would say any breed. Now, like for example, a Rottweiler or a Doberman, for the matter of fact. Yes, premolars, if it's missing, it should be disqualified or penalized or whatever. Because yes, it's a guard dog. It needs all its teeth to get a good bite on its wing when it's doing its work. There you go.
Yeah.
So based on what the functionality of the breed is, why it was developed, then you can progress and see what was lacking, add it on, what's missing in your dog.
That's nice. So, I mean, labs, I mean, moving on to the next question, I think, labs, in a sense, apart from show rings, I think this is something that labs are actually used for. Can you throw some insight on the roles that Labrador retrievers are at sight and assistant dog?
See, basically, like I mentioned to you, they have lovely temperaments. It's a medium-sized, strong dog, muscular dog, because of which, and it's a biddable dog, so it wants to please the owner, easy to train. All these traits of a Labrador, which makes it a good pet also, makes it a good thing for the disabled also, you mentioned, people to work with. Because again, being a strong dog, people can hold on to the dog and try and pull themselves. If someone has a walking issue, they can do that. the dog will not snap or bite at you because it has that pain threshold in it, which has been there for a reason. So it won't bite at you. It's a friendly dog. It's easy to train. It's a sweet dog, loving dog. Whatever you want, it would do. Because of which, it becomes an ideal thing for this work. Again, temperament, easy to take care of. Again, so person who's not, has a problem with your way, he wants a dog which is like a low maintenance dog. You don't want a high maintenance dog. I mean, you yourself are trying to do things with the help of a dog, and you have to brush the dog and comb the dog and, you know, groom it and all that stuff. So that all that goes off. So it's a low maintenance dog, lovely temperament, biddable, always there to please you, quick to learn. These traits make it a suitable dog for the disabled and as a blind sight dog as well.
Oh, nice. We have another question right from Mr. Radhakrishnan. He's asked about, can you talk about color breeding and about do's and don'ts about mixing black, yellow and chocolate? Do they do actually do that? I mean, are they color?
Again, this is a very, it's not an easy thing, but yeah, you have, it's a genetic trait which is already there in Labradors. So you have to see which is a dominant color which they have. There are charts on it. So with that chart explains to you that if you breed a black and a yellow, what are the genetic color inherent which they have? Based on that, how many pups can be this color or that color? What dominance will they have in color wise? So it's a complicated thing, but yes, it can be done. Generally, people don't breed chocolate to black or yellow. That is generally avoided. Why? Because, see, the chocolate has a lighter color eye. And the yellows and blacks are supposed to have a brown to hazel color eye. But it shouldn't be a dark eye, like a black or something should not be there. Because that gives, again, spoils the impression, the expression of the dog. So it has to be a thing. But it should not be a light eye also. But the browns, chocolates have a light eye. So we don't want that light eye coming into the, it's like an amber color thing, and get the thing. It's a light color which you don't want coming into the yellows and the blacks. So generally, one does not breed a chocolate to a black or to a yellow for that particular reason. So you do a chocolate to a chocolate or so, it's much better. You don't want that lighter color coming into your.
We have this is actually a question that I think I wanted. I mean, this is something is very prevalent. Labrador is still one of the strongest NPs in clubs and the world's biggest show. But since 1937, the Cowdery Trophy has never been eluding the breed. What are your views on this?
Well, I think in 1915 or 13, somewhere then, there's a very nice dog. See, as I said, there's so many dogs which are nice. You can't just put a kennel thing. Italian dog called Romeo. He came, I think, if I'm not mistaken, if I'm correct, I think he came reserve best in show. So he did come close to winning best in show. He came reserve, which is again very good thing for an Italian dog to come in and Romeo and winning that thing. So there it is there. But yes, Labradors haven't come best in show in crafts for a long time, long time. But then you also have to see there are so many breeds, so many attractive breeds when you go to the crafts. I mean, every group has so many. I mean, you know, you never see them in India. I don't think you can see so many gun dogs which come up in that group today as compared to our country. We have just a few or five of them or so. They don't come in. And like I earlier mentioned to you, if you take just the gun dog group, they are flashy dogs. You know, when they move, they are far. They are literally floating. Their hair flowing, like the setters and things, hair flowing. Even the American Cocker Spaniel, for example, we have a lot in India. You see them. I mean, they're very elegant when they're moving. It's like this is a floating on the thing, so much reach and covering ground. They look lovely. So when you compete with that, I mean, Labrador is not an elegant dog. It's not an elegant dog. It's, you know, it's like a workhorse kind of a thing. You know, he's built to work. You know, he's not there for elegance and beauty. So, and basically, dog shows are like competitions for beauty.
For the beauty, exactly.
Go there and compete over there. I feel there's so many of these other dogs, it gets difficult for the Labrador. It gets difficult in India also, I know this. I mean, you might have a lovely Labrador, but when the moment the Cocker Spaniel comes in or a really nice American kind of a golden retriever, it gets a little difficult because they're so well groomed and the way they move that the Labrador, kind of gets sidelined. He's not that flashy a dog to get the judging attention. And I feel that is the reason why they are not coming up there. The Romeo did a great job and he came up there. That's lovely. This is our best in show. Again, like I said, 2013 or somewhere there, I mean, thing came in and did it. But apart from that, yes, Labradors haven't reached on the top 3, 4, 5
thing. But I think
it's more of the judges' preference at the end of the day as well. Like at any show, I suppose, like if be it Crufts or be it even a small show, the judge looks at it in a very different way. Each judge, I think, looks at it in a very different way, and he chooses the dog that comes up or goes down in his own. He's got his own reasoning.
Yeah, he has his preference. Everyone has their own preferences as to what they like, which breed they like, or in the breed, what do they like. You know, I mean, they all, everyone has their preferences. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I mean, and to come, I mean, like, the Crufts has nothing less than 20,000-25,000 dogs. So, like, to
huge number.
So, to be one among the best in the 25,000, it takes a lot for the dog to, like, come up there. That's true. Perfect. So, we have two more questions. One on a very lighter note. This is, what other breeds do you like other than retrievers?
Well, my first love has always been Rottweilers, and I've kept them for 25 years. And And other breeds, I've also had Cavalier King Charles Spaniel, which is a lovely breed, but and now they've become quite old. But yeah, these are the two main breeds, three breeds which I've kept. And now I'm keen to get Dobermans again, because I want something which is even less maintenance and could excite my type of Doberman. I believe we leave them loose and they'll really run, get the exercise and come back. So yes, and I also match it with my lifestyle. So I feel my lifestyle seems going to be changing in the next couple of years. So a dog like that would be better in the plane with less.
Doberman is a good meat, the thinker. You're coming into my beat. You're basically coming into
older, so yeah, I don't feel scared that they'll snap at them or something. So yeah.
Perfect. This question that we generally ask all our guests who come in to talk to about the beat. What are the three main, or rather, what are the three best dogs that you've seen worldwide? And what are the three best dogs you have seen, bred, or owned, or seen in the show ring in India? You know,
I'm not really good at names. And plus, it's not fair, like I said, being such a popular breed. There's so many dogs which are very nice. And naming just a few is not a thing. But I know you regularly ask this question. And if I talk names, most people will not understand. You know, I could say X, Y, Z and...
This is a recorded session, so people can always like go rewind and note down the name and Google it or something like that.
I've actually got some pictures, so people could see these pictures and they could understand better about them. So I'll just put those pictures on. There's no order as such, and go through it. Let me just try and open it up.
I haven't closed it. I have just minimized it from my end. So once you choose the pictures, I can put it back on.
No, I have actually.
I think you have closed.
Just let me just try and get that folder back. I just minimize the screen 2 minutes.
No problem.
Let me just repeat it. Yeah, have you got them now? So there you go. I mean, it's again the English dog, which is there. Also, see the pigmentation of the nose. I don't know if I mentioned it or not. See, this can fade at times. People say it's pink nose. Not pink nose. It can fade in colder climates and winters. But the thing is, for the Indian context, I can say it has like a kajal around its eye. That you know that the pigmentation is correct. The nose can fade and it's not a fault or so. So it should not be penalized. But some people may try and penalize. Has that thing again gone off?
Yeah, I think you've closed your folder.
It's here. But
you can just click on it.
So again, this is a nice dog. Has the bitch. And have a look. These are all English dogs. The black and whites are all English dogs. So you have this English dog. But see the expression, you get an idea of what these English dogs are about. The names are mentioned there.
Okay.
there was a Mansair kennel over there in the UK, which again was known for its lovely heads.
Okay.
Now, this again is a dog, a Scottish dog, Pseudo Deacon Ruby, a famous kennel. I have his daughter with me. He's a lovely dog name. And you can see the difference. That's again a light yellow now. If you see that, I mean, it's not a yellow, yellow like people want. It's getting lighter. The Russians have made it even lighter. So there you go. That's a
version of the lighter. Yeah.
There you go. Now, this is, I mean, you can say it's a white. It's not a white, it's a yellow.
Right. Exactly.
This fashion comes in, and then dogs which are there start being converted to this. It's a recent picture of the dogs, 2020. And top winning dog in the US, I'm told.
US. Okay.
Yeah. Bellquist again is a very famous kennel. This is a breeding by Sonia, which I'd mentioned, Bellamere. You know, this is a bitch.
Okay.
Let's give an idea. Fire water vacation from Bellamere.
Okay.
Again, a famous dog called, this is a Dickendale dog, Three Dog Night. The Dickendale Buckstone Three Dog Night. He's a grand champion, American. But you can see the difference now. Like why I've showed you the English and I'm showing you the, also the American. You can see the difference in the dogs. These are bulkier dogs.
These are more heavier dogs. Yeah.
Yeah. So again, the standard, see the standard, again, where it differs is this, that the UK dogs are smaller in size. And that's how it should be actually medium size. The US dogs, unfortunately, are picking up a bit too bulky and big. Here there's grass, but you can see the distances from the withers to the elbow, and from the elbow to the ground. I mean, the short legs, you know. So there's more length of legs over here is required. This dog is again.
Heavier dogs are actually okay in the sense they are. You know,
if you had Siddharth a heavy dog, it would sink. I mean, in the water it would sink. It won't float.
Yeah.
It's heavy, you know, and the fisherman would not be able to bring it into the boat, pull it into the boat. And if it's in the boat, I mean, it will take too much space. If it's too big a dog, that's why it's a medium-sized dog. Yes, these are all square dogs, but I see the size in the US, they've increased it too much.
Okay.
That's my personal view. I mean, no disrespect to anyone. They're lovely dogs, like I said, that's why I put them over here. This is a very famous dog from Rockabilly Kennels, again, Old Smokey.
Okay.
He's sired a lot of good dogs, and he's also sired a dog which I really like. And I will be showing you, which are this is the same dog. It's been sired by him. I'll show you a better picture. There you go.
Nice.
So see this. Now this is what a typical Labrador should be. Now you can compare it to the US dogs. They're lovely dogs. I mean, both are lovely dogs. But here, if you see, you can see the differences. I mean, you know, pictures say a lot as compared to my words, and I'm not good at words. And,
you've been doing great.
The reach of necks, it has to be not a long neck, not a short neck, it shouldn't be a stubby neck. It's just right. So you can pick up the bird easily from the ground and then move on. You know?
Right.
So these are the things which have to the head again. See, it has to be in proportion to the body. If it's too big a head, a broke head, it won't be able to move in the water or it'll just sink. When it has the bird also in its mouth or the fish in its mouth, it's too heavy. It will become too big and heavy, the head will just go. The balance goes off.
True, that's true.
And the otter tail, you can see it wagging. And
yeah.
The dog is a lovely dog. I really like this dog. And this is again by John and Shaudia, their lifetime achievements. You see. I'm being a little selfish, and this is another dog which I really like. And this is my dog. But he's in between, I would say, the English and the American. And I really like this dog. Again, you can see he's quite this thing. He's got this yellow thing on top. Otherwise, he's also quite. White. His granddaughter is with me. She's not white. She's become a little less. And his daughter is also not like this. And that's how it should be. His son is identical like him.
Perfect. So we have time for one last question. There's one gentleman asked this. Can you say a few words for youngsters who are seriously involved in Labradors? Like what are the points to be focused to go along with?
See, again, like I said, you have to study the breed. Any breed, I mean, I am still new. I'm still learning. I'm no professional. That's why I said I'm still learning. I may be wrong in what I may have said today. But you have to study the breed. A mentor is very important. Unfortunately, it's very difficult. I was fortunate enough, like I mentioned, I got John and Sodia. Fortunately, I also got Carol Cody to mentor me in the beginning. Sonia, like I said, has Jill from Visco has also mentored me partly. And it helps you when you have a mentor who spent 35, 50, 60 years with the breed. They can give you a lot of insight. See, unfortunately, a lot of young people want to, you know, it's like earning money, quick money. It doesn't happen that way. It takes a long time to this thing. It took me 2 years to get this Labrador, researching the whole world, then getting him here. And it's going to take me some time to further breed 2-3 generations. And then I would say, yes, I have achieved something. So yeah, do your research, read a lot of books. There's lots of stuff lying online. Try and get a mentor, a correct mentor, which is difficult to get because it's a very time consuming thing for a mentor to spend so much time with you. But if you can get a good mentor, it would help you, or get a guide maybe in India as well, who can help you in the basics. But then, yeah, like I said, see pictures, you know, just, I mean, pictures tell you a lot more. That's why I got pictures there, because I might not be able to, I might be thinking something, but I'm not being able to express it in my words. Because of which I got those pictures out, so you can understand it better. Similarly, look at the pictures, see the dogs, what do you like, and why was the dog bred or developed, the reason, and what are the things which it should have, like I'd explained, those are the things you should be looking at, regardless of what breed, it's a Labrador, and see for that particular thing, why was it developed, what it should have, which makes it a Labrador, it can do its work efficiently without wasting too much power and energy. So that's what you should be doing, read a lot of books, see a lot of pictures, go to dog shows, have a look, but that might not be the right thing. The dog which is winning might not be the best dog standard-wise. I mean, it's winning that we discussed earlier for various reasons. But yes, have a look. If you agree with the thing who's winning and think it's good, yeah, then go ahead, further discuss with the breeder if he's friendly enough to further discuss some of them or not. So yeah, see that.
Find the right person for you to learn from. That's what you basically.
Yeah, basically you need to learn. Don't be in a hurry. If you think within a year, 2 years, I'm going to have a best in show winner, or I'm going to do this, it's not going to happen. And people have spent years, like I said, people have spent 30, 40, 50 years, and then they've achieved or they've reached where they think, yeah, I've got something which is really close to the standard. There is no perfect dog, but it's that work, time and effort, studying pedigrees, looking at dogs, reading books, trying to understand, talking to people, it takes time. It doesn't happen. A lot of youngsters want it to happen, you know, instantly. It doesn't happen. I'm looking for a Doberman for the last 2 years. It's taken me 2 years. I haven't still picked up my Doberman. Because what I like is something which when you are at home, you look at your dog or the dog playing in your garden, it should get a smile on your face. That's what I see. I see my dog like that. If it doesn't get a smile on my face, I'm sorry, I don't like that dog. Why should I have that dog? So it takes time. It's a lifelong commitment.
Yeah, exactly.
So you should buy something or get something which you really like and which you move forward with. And that's what I would say. You should like it. I mean, basically, you should like it and study the standard. And you should say, yeah, it's closer to the standard. Discuss with people. Try and get a mentor. And that would be, I think, the best way to move forward, in my opinion.
Well said. Yeah, exactly. I mean, you learn from your peers. I mean, you learn from the people who have been involved with the breed or who've been having the same breed for a long time or who have been associated with a lot of dogs, you basically learn from them. That's how you gain the knowledge. Yeah, you seeing the dog and learning is one thing, but their insight and their knowledge is more valuable than what you actually see and what you interrupt as well. Perfect. Thank you so much, Mr. Dinkar. We just have about run out of time. Thank you for this lovely session. Thanks for educating a lot of people about labs. I mean, that is something
I hope I could help people with whatever little information and knowledge I have. It's a learning process, so I'm not perfect. I'm still learning. But thank you for having me and pushing me to be here, because I'm the last person to come on. You know,
You ask a lot of thought-provoking questions in our chat sessions. We have seen it in the past.
I'm genuinely interested. See, like I said, I'm genuinely a dog lover, bird lover, pet lover. I've had them all my life. So I'm genuinely interested. When I take a breed, I really thoroughly study and understand the whole thing, and you know, otherwise it's no point. And yeah,
we are looking forward to more questions in the near future. Definitely, for sure. Thank you so much, Mr. Dinkar. Thank you so much, viewers, for tuning in with us today evening. Watch out for our Facebook page. We will be putting up shortly our next week's guest speaker with another interesting topic, another interesting read. Till then, stay home, stay safe. I think that's what is more required right now. So all of you, thank you so much and good night.
Thank you. Bye.